mind me taking a little bit of time to ask you to look through that and decide how much you're going to give. It's not an if, all right? No, it is. But everything that you can contribute will helps the sort of research that Parkland does on an ongoing basis. So welcome to the second breakout of the conference. This one's called The Politics of Truth in Alberta. I think the most positive thing that's happened so far is that none of you have tinfoil hats on just yet. So we'll see what we can do about that. Maybe we can get them on by the end of this session. We're going to talk about the Alberta situation in particular here. This session's going to provide an opportunity to consider the control, suppression, and manipulation of information within our own province. It's going to address the consequences for democracy when information is manipulated and alternative perspectives are suppressed. Again, there's no if. It's happening, so it'll be good. We have two great speakers, and many of you will know both of them, but I'm going to introduce them both at this time and then invite them to come forward. Shannon Stunden Bower is on staff with Parkland. She's the chief researcher, but that's totally not the right thing, but that she's a researcher at Parkland anyhow. She's the research director at the Parkland Institute. She has a background in social and environmental justice issues and is the author of numerous reports and articles dealing with historical, geographical, and public policy issues. She holds a PhD in geography from UBC and lives in Edmonton. Our second speaker is going to be Kevin Taft, and he spent most of his career working on public policy in Alberta in the nonprofit and private sectors and with government as an MLA and as leader of the Alberta opposition. He has written extensively on public policy in Alberta, including 4 books. The most recent, co-authored with Mel McMillan and Janae Janger, was Follow the Money and focused on Alberta's fiscal situation. Kevin has a PhD in business and lives in Edmonton as well. So we're looking forward to hearing from both. And first, Shannon, why don't you come up and have a little bit of time. And following that, Kevin, I'll just invite you to come right up after her.
Thanks, Jerry, and thanks to all of you for being here today. So across Canada, citizens are concerned about how their governments are manipulating the production and dissemination of information. Attention has rightly focused on Stephen Harper's conservative federal government, and we've heard a lot about this already today, principally in the previous session. From the muzzling of government scientists to the cancellation of Statistics Canada's long-form census, federal government practices have undermined Canadians' access to the data required for evidence-based policy on pressing issues such as climate change and income inequality. While the federal government deserves all the scrutiny it is getting, the activities of provincial governments also merit attention, and I hope this session will provide an opportunity to reflect on the situation in our own province. So my goal in this presentation is to provide some information about the recent history and current state of provincial practices in relation to information and evidence. It will compare some of the claims that have been made by Premier Alison Redford and her government with the administration's track record in relation to these issues. My talk will draw on research conducted on particular issues by Parkland Institute that serves to illustrate broader patterns. Connecting these dots offer a picture of the recent track record of the Alberta government in relation to information issues. So since its election, Alison Redford's Progressive Conservative government has worked hard to position itself as a champion of openness. It has put in place initiatives that are presented as increasing the availability of information while presenting itself as profoundly interested in listening to the input of Albertans. And just some examples here, in October 2012, Redford's government launched a website dedicated to the public disclosure of travel and expense claims submitted by politicians and senior civil servants. Redford said the change would allow Alberta to lead the country with respect to online disclosure of expenses. Spring 2013 saw the launch of the Alberta Open Data Portal. I've extracted a visual from the website pertaining to this initiative. So this is a website purported to facilitate access to government information. The Service Alberta Minister said that this initiative reflected the government's commitment to a new way of doing business, one that values the proactive sharing of information, and this portal builds on that commitment. As of the end of October 2013, one final example here, the government of Alberta had undertaken 24 public consultations in the last 18 months. Redford has described the overarching goal here as the opening of a conversation with Albertans. Public consultations have included topics such as water, education, social policy, and freedom of information legislation, just to name a few examples. So taken at face value, these various initiatives would seem aimed at creating a two-way flow of information between governments and citizens. The key question then for us today is, does the Alberta government live up to its claims and its positioning? If we look at major policy directions or pieces of legislation advanced by this administration, do we see a commitment to openness borne out? So let's look at research done by Parkland to see if we can shed light on that question. The first example I'll be exploring derives from a report we did on the LRT extension. As all Edmontonians in the room will know, the City of Edmonton is looking to expand its light rail system. The mechanism through which the construction of the southeast to west line is to be undertaken has proven controversial. Faced with the conditions imposed by the federal government, the City of Edmonton decided to go ahead with a public-private partnership arrangement. P3s involve shifting a range of functions typically performed by the public service onto private entities. They represent in that way a form of privatization. While it was the federal government that brought down the hammer in this instance, the Alberta government's enthusiasm for the P3 method of infrastructure construction is clear. Not least of all through Premier Redford's role as the honorary chair of the Canadian Council for Public-Private Partnership, which amounts to an industry-funded lobby group. Nationally, P3s have a very worrying track record in relation to access to information, with the public's right to know frequently trumped by overzealous protection of the perceived economic interests of private parties. What happens is that certain provisions of freedom of information and protection of privacy legislation provide for the denial of access to information that can be seen to impinge on a private company's competitive advantage, and that these provisions are interpreted in ways that limit the public's ability to monitor the expenditure of public funds. So because the City of Edmonton falls under Alberta's Freedom of Information legislation, FOIP legislation, and because the city and the province maintain broadly consistent policies on P3s, the example of Edmonton's LRT P3 reflects on the province. The recent example of the P3 proposed for Edmonton's LRT extension makes clear that Alberta is no exception to the national pattern in terms of how P3s undermine public access to information. So Parkland Institute, to explore the P3 being considered here, wanted to undertake an independent examination by a qualified expert in order to determine if the decision to proceed with the under conditions of P3 was economically justifiable. Did it make sense to go ahead in this way? Because the key document, the business case and risk register, was not made publicly available, Parkland sought it under FOIP legislation. We were eventually granted the document in severely redacted form, and what I'm showing you today is a typical example of one page from the report. It's not the worst, it's not the case where we got the most information. Everything I've highlighted in yellow amounts to a piece of information to which we were denied access. In the Parkland Institute report, based on this document, this severely redacted document, economist and P3 expert John Loxley explained that the documentation pertaining to this project, accessed through FOIP, was so severely censored as to make it impossible to judge definitely whether the case for the P3 approach is valid. So it is hard to see how any private entity could have been impaired by full disclosure in the case of the Edmonton LRT. And to explain why that is, I need to tell you something further about this document. The document, the so-called business case, did not include real numbers submitted by a firm interested in taking on the work. Rather, business case documents are made up of reasonable guesses put forward by a consulting firm hired to compare in the abstract the cost of public sector to the cost of P3 delivery. There was no real data here at stake. And yet even these best guess numbers were not made available to us. In Dr. Loxley's expert opinion, information restrictions on this project extend well beyond even the information restrictions that characterize P3s elsewhere in Canada. So we should ask ourselves, does this amount to increasing the transparency of government business? The second example I'll talk to today derives from a report Parkland Institute did on whistleblower legislation. In late 2012, Redford's government passed the Public Interest Disclosure Whistleblower Protection Act. Presented as making good on a long-standing promise, the government argued this legislation offered meaningful safeguards to Alberta whistleblowers. What's a whistleblower? Well, whistleblowers are employees or citizens who speak up about perceived misconduct that threatens to cause harm to either people or the public interest. They see something that they believe is wrong and they speak up. Whistleblowers often suffer devastating consequences for their actions. Hostility in the workplace, job loss, unemployability, tarnished reputation are among some of the negative effects that can ensue from the decision to blow the whistle. Whistleblower protection legislation is to offer some measure of protection from these potentially devastating consequences. Best practices in terms of whistleblower protection legislation are by now well established internationally. As David Hutton, author of the Parkland Whistleblower Report and Executive Director of FAIR, a whistleblower advocacy group, has explained, there is no excuse today for legislators in any jurisdiction to enact badly written laws. We know enough to do it well. Alberta legislation disregards best practices in a number of ways, Hutton found in his expert assessment of our new legislation. I'd just like to highlight, given our topic today, a few shortcomings from an openness perspective. First, it is significant that this legislation applies only to public bodies. Given that the Alberta government is actively shrinking the public service and expanding the private sector, a government committed to public interest disclosure should have produced legislation that encompasses the private sector. Secondly, the legislation does not obligate reports to the Public Interest Commissioner, the body mandated to manage whistleblower protection for Alberta, to be made public. Rather, the commissioner seems very much a creature of government, rather than an independent investigator responsible to the public, to all of us. There's an inherent irony within this legislation, supposedly in the public interest, but given the potentially secretive nature of the process, there's very little that's public about it. So again, does this amount to increasing the transparency of government business? I'd like to give one final example from recent Parkland Institute research. This is our most recently released project on residential elder care in Alberta. The aspects of this report that are rightly getting the most attention are those detailing the abysmal, absolutely abysmal treatment of Alberta elders in residential elder care, particularly those in for-profit institutions. The circumstances in which caregivers work, we found, are not such as to enable them to provide the quality of care they recognize patients deserve. But even some more basic findings of this report have received attention. Particularly, our calculation of the number of long-term care beds in the province between 1999 and 2009, the period encompassed within our data set, was significant because this is a number that the government of Alberta is unwilling to talk about. The government of Alberta prefers to enumerate continuing care beds, which is a number that includes beds serving people in need of care for reasons other than advanced age, perhaps due to degenerative illness or injury. To speak of continuing care, then, can be a way of sidestepping what is actually happening in residential elder care. So our report also makes clear, and this slide, I should explain, does make clear what actually happened in terms of residential long-term care beds. You see that over the period in question, there was a 20% reduction in LTC, long-term care beds. There was a 187% increase in assisted living beds, which is another form of residential elder care. But overall, this amounted to a 4% decline in residential elder care beds available to serve Albertans. Our report also makes clear that changes in residential elder care serve to decrease our knowledge of what goes on in elder care facilities. We track the expansion of assisted living, as I've explained, and this care model offers lesser regulation and fewer standards than does long-term care. Instead of working to improve the performance of the elder care system, it would seem that the provincial government is interested in moving away from monitoring performance in an ongoing, rigorous manner. Our report on residential elder care is based primarily on two data sets, both of which have now been eliminated. Statistics Canada currently does not track residential elder care across Canada, and Alberta recently eliminated the body that used to make unannounced visits to long-term care facilities as well as other health facilities in the province. One of our report's key recommendations was that the province of Alberta move to address the information vacuum within elder care. Again, does this amount to an increase in the transparency of government business? So, in sum, inconsistencies between the government claims about its information policies and its actions with respect to various major policies or pieces of legislation are what come to the fore in my read of this evidence. There's a contradiction between a government that is presenting itself as favoring information availability and continuing to behave in ways that diminish information availability. One connection that I think is important to draw out of the examples I've given today is privatization. Moving things into the private sector tends to erode our ability to monitor them, and the provincial government has shown little willingness to impose reporting requirements on private industry. Because of this, at this point in time, to shrink the public sector is to diminish public access to information. So an examination of recent government policies, practices, and legislation would seem to suggest there is reason for skepticism regarding the Redford government's commitment to openness. What if we turn the skeptical eye to the very actions that the government has cited as a means of demonstrating its purported commitment to openness? So what if we look again at the examples I gave right at the beginning? Well, I think we find that even recent government initiatives explicitly intended to demonstrate openness fail to stand up to scrutiny. So let's take a closer look at the open data portal, which I referred to right at the beginning. Along with whatever basic data may be offered by this portal, it also provides processed information designed to bolster the government's policy agenda. This is dramatically evident in a data set uploaded earlier this summer that offers what the government calls an interprovincial tax and health premium comparison. It sounds like a pretty basic piece of data. No. What this document actually offers is an accounting of the so-called Alberta advantage in terms of low taxes, illustrating how Albertans are supposedly benefiting from the province's fiscal policy. The document does not deal with, first, the forfeited tax revenues that could have paid for the social services needed to promote greater income equality in Canada's most unequal province, what we at Parkland have included in Alberta's revenue gap, or two, the way the tax burden rests differently in different Canadian provinces, with Albertans in low middle incomes carrying a heavier tax burden than others in different Canadian provinces. So Alberta's so-called data portal is not offering evidence, but ideology, a perspective that is clearly aimed at convincing Albertans they are benefiting from the government's governing party's fiscal policy. There is a big difference between the data being provided by the government of Alberta and the sort of basic statistical data that, at least once upon a time, was collected in abundance by Statistics Canada. With respect to the open data portal, the government of Alberta is not giving us information. What they are giving us is an argument for a particular way of seeing the world, one that supports the maintenance of the political status quo. So let's look more closely at expense reporting. So expense reporting, like public disclosure of salaries above some identified benchmark, is a practice that can offer immediate public appeal. It's a proactive offering of information. Surely this is good. Well, here's the problem. Exposing public sector expense claims amounts to a bone thrown to a public kept in the dark about the decisions that carry much greater fiscal consequences. This is an example of the sort of information you get through accessing the expense disclosure website at this point in time. Over the years, Parkland Institute has tried on multiple occasions to analyze the dollar value of contracts going to private providers of public services. Well, we've managed to learn enough to know that this sort of thing is increasing. We've never received access to the data necessary to really understand the financial implications of this practice. The dollars at stake dwarf the inappropriate spending that may have happened in the past to prompt this sort of policy. In place of data that would allow for critical thinking about fiscal policy, privatization, and P3s, Albertans are offered a flood of largely inconsequential information about which government functionary ate at which mid-priced restaurant on what day. We're invited to scrutinize the lunch bill while billions of dollars in public funds may be on their way out the door. While public disclosure of expenses may have a deterrent effect of some sort, the availability of such information can be deceiving if it enables the provincial government to position itself as a champion of openness, even while manipulating or suppressing other, more important types of data. Let's talk briefly about public consultations, which is a key way the government positions itself to increase citizen involvement in government. There's been a very basic problem with the public consultation process. Many people don't know what's going on. This slide here reflects a poll conducted by Environics Research Group in June 2013, and it indicates that less than a quarter of Albertans were aware, even aware, never mind participating, that consultations took place on water issues. 80% of Albertans were completely unaware. Similar problems with communications have come into evidence in relation to other public consultations that have taken place. So if this is a conversation with Albertans, it's a pretty one-sided one. Another problem relates to the nature of the consultation process itself. This is a problem that will be all too familiar to those among you who have tried to participate via any online survey in one of these consultation processes. The experience of taking an online survey is often tantamount to getting caught in a feedback loop. So you might call up a screen, please comment on whether this issue is important to you, yes or no. The next screen will say, how should we take action on this important issue? And enumerate a variety of ways. That implies that it's important. You haven't acknowledged that. If you answered no to the first question, to participate further in the survey, you need to change your answer, in effect. This is not an appropriate way to conduct public consultations. So in sum, ultimately, in my assessment, the provincial government's efforts to position itself as favoring openness don't stand up to scrutiny. So just briefly, in conclusion, my key point is that a government that claims to be making big strides toward openness actually maintains policies and practices and has introduced legislation that conceal key data from scrutiny. And now as a transition into Kevin's talk, I'll push a little further and say that a government that isn't open or accountable is bad for democracy. A government that pretends openness and accountability while suppressing information, stifling criticism, and drastically curtailing public debate is worse.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? No? How's that? Oh, there we go. I'll talk loud enough to be heard. Actually, I probably don't need the mic if I really get excited here. Just going to start with three. First of all, thank you very much, Shannon. As you were flashing up those expense accounts, I was remembering joyously mischievous moments in the legislature going after Ralph Klein for spending $18 on a glass of orange juice and things like that. Always thinking in the back of my mind, I'm sure there's bigger issues than this out there. So just to kind of set the mood. And next. Whoops. That's why I don't operate those buttons. Okay, That's good. Just wanted to give you a sense of the scale of the oil sands in Alberta. Think back to 2007 and the political debate in Alberta then as it related to the petroleum industry. The government's own royalty review panel had concluded that the people of Alberta were not getting their fair share in royalties and that royalties should rise. Do you remember that? There was heated debate across the province about tailings ponds, land reclamation, coal bed methane, fracking, an overheated economy, the behavior of regulators, cancer rates in Fort Chip, and on and on. These topics, especially royalty rates, became defining issues in the 2008 general election. These were the political truths in Alberta of that day. Fast forward to 2013. How often do you hear significant debates originating in Alberta, like they used to, on these issues? When there are stories on these topics, and there are, they are most often driven from outside the province, from the United States, from BC, or even from Europe. Inside Alberta, both the government and the official opposition refuse to consider any debates on royalties. And while debates on fracking wrench other provinces and countries, they've gone quiet here. The debate on tailings ponds and land reclamation has fallen to a whisper, as have the debates on toxic pollutants, cancer rates, and regulatory agencies. It's not that these problems have disappeared. What's happened is that the issues that count as political truths in Alberta have been drastically and deliberately rewritten. The 2008 general election was a turning point. It alarmed Alberta's petroleum industry, particularly the stance by all the major political parties that royalties needed to be increased. And the immediate response of the industry, and I was pretty close to this, was to freeze all political donations across the board. But it's really the longer-term response that needs examination. How's this sound system working? Yeah, it's okay. To some extent, the power of the petroleum industry in Alberta is inevitable. Just like the fishing industry in Newfoundland has a lot of influence, or the auto industry in Michigan, or the tourism industry in Hawaii. Alberta, with a total population considerably less than Phoenix, has the third largest oil reserves in the world. So, of course, the petroleum industry swings a lot of weight here. And Alberta's petroleum industry is one of the most sophisticated in the world. But that doesn't mean it's a good idea to turn the keys to the province over to the industry. Alberta's petroleum industry is not a monolith, but in the end, its interests are consistent. Different individuals and groups within the industry have differing priorities and attitudes, but taken as a whole, the industry is driving Alberta and increasingly Canada down the highway to petrostate status. So let's, oh, that was my title slide. Okay. Petrostates are defined by certain traits which can develop in stages, one leading to the next, and you can see them on that slide. First, there needs to be an economy dominated by petroleum production. And what's special about petroleum is that it's unusually lucrative because cartel economics maintain an artificial price for oil. Second, the government needs to become heavily dependent on petroleum revenues to subsidize public services and to keep taxes low. Third, there needs to be a weakening of democratic institutions. And fourth, there's often widespread corruption and reliance on an internal security apparatus to keep order. Now in Alberta, we've passed through those first two stages. And let's be realistic here, we're not at the fourth. None of us are expecting to get arrested on the way home from this conference. at least not for being political. But we are well into the third. I don't think there's any doubt that our democratic institutions and voices are being compromised as we head toward the petro-state. I'm going to look at four of these today. Starting with politics. After the 2008 election, certain groups and individuals in the petroleum industry, largely out of the junior sector, vowed never again. They were determined to take much greater direct control of Alberta politics. They worked through various industry associations, notably through a new organization called Protect the Patch, which you can learn about if you click here. I just put that up, take notes, do your own research. You'll find if you search this term on the web, there's been some efforts to hide the trails, but it won't take long for you to get past those. The greatest success of this group, Protect the Patch, has been the rise of the Wild Rose Party in the past 5 years. Members of Protect the Patch are among the biggest fundraisers for Wild Rose. They've set many of its policies, they've provided organizational capacity, and they sit on the board of Wild Rose. On top of that, they provided 13 candidates for the Wild Rose in the 2012 election, including a handful who now sit as MLAs. At the same time this was happening, other industry groups maintained intense pressure on the governing PCs. The demise of Ed Stelmach, who commissioned the Royalty Review Panel, is one indication of the power of the petroleum lobby. They wanted him out, so he was gone. In the 2012 election, the petroleum industry, through the PCs and Wild Rose, captured control of both the government and the official opposition. With this stranglehold, the debates that dominated the 2008 election simply disappeared from the legislature. This was quickly followed by changes in government policy. For example, you can see above the difference from before the 2008 election in the goals in the government's goals for collecting royalties. These are actual quotes from government documents. Up until the 2008 election, the government actually put out a quantifiable goal of what they wanted to collect in royalties, 20 to 25%. They never made it, but I could stand up in the legislature and ask the premier, why did your government only collect 18%? Fast forward a few years, that's now the government's goal for royalties. You translate that, and what the government's goal for royalties is to make Alberta one of the most business-friendly royalty regimes in the world. That's what happens when the politics change here. So welcome to Petro-State Alberta. Let's go to the next one here. Another stop on the Petro-State Highway is the universities. There have been a troubling number of controversies involving universities in the petroleum industry for years, and you might have noticed in the paper just this week, a new report from outside Alberta, I'll note, raised further concerns. I'm going to focus today on the University of Calgary School of Public Policy, which was set up after the 2008 election. It started off by enjoying $1 million donation from Imperial Oil to help it get established, and the position of the chair of the school was endowed by one of Calgary's most senior oil executives. On its website, it bills itself as Canada's flagship school of public policy. The person who heads up the school is a well-known economist and tax analyst. He publishes papers under the University of Calgary banner and frequently appears in the media on topics including corporate taxes and royalty systems. Here's my concern. This professor is also on the board of Imperial Oil. And this isn't just a token position. He sits on the board, the audit committee, the executive resources committee, and three other board committees. Imperial Oil's most recent annual report says he was compensated with about $200,000 in 2012 for this position, and that over several years, he's accumulated almost exactly $1 million worth of Imperial Oil common shares. In return for this compensation, like all board members, he's obligated to advance the interests of Imperial Oil. Now, I want to be fair here. This professor does disclose his position with Imperial Oil at the end of the papers that he publishes with the U of Calgary, though this connection is generally overlooked by the media that carry his commentaries. But I think it's time that the public asked, is it appropriate for the University of Calgary to allow a faculty member who heads one of its most prominent institutes to simultaneously serve on the board of Imperial Oil? Given the legal obligations, these are serious legal obligations on members of the board of Imperial Oil to serve its corporate interests, what does that indicate about the independence of the university? Or are we just to assume that the interests of Imperial Oil and the interests of the university are one and the same? In a petrostate, maybe they are. We'll move on. One of the roles of government is to regulate industry, in part to protect the public interest. The Alberta government began regulating the petroleum industry in the 1930s through the ERCB. In 2012, the Alberta government passed the Responsible Energy Development Act. This legislation drastically changed the regulatory processes for the petroleum industry in Alberta. Among the biggest changes, A, it removed from legislation all reference to protecting the public interest, which was actually in the previous legislation. And B, it weakened the quasi-judicial arm's-length nature of the regulator and made it much more vulnerable to influence directly from the Minister of Energy. In addition, the chairman of the new regulator is a former head of the Canadian Association of Petroleum Producers, CAP. CAP is the energy industry's largest special interest group. You might have seen their beautiful television ads recently. And they are the oil industry's most powerful lobbyist. The end result of this new legislation is that the primary regulator of the energy industry has no specific responsibility to protect the public interest and is chaired by the former head of the industry's biggest interest group. Another length of pavement on the highway to becoming a petrostate. I'm going to give you a second example of the demise of balanced regulatory agencies in Alberta. And actually, this has made it into the newspapers. Graham Thompson has written a couple of good pieces on this recently. You anticipate me. Very good. If you're wanting more background on this, one of the wonders of the web is you can actually get the judge's ruling on this if you just search 2013 Queen's Bench on Pembina. This case concerns the Environmental Protection and Enhancement Act and the Water Act. Oil sands developers need to apply for permits under these acts for their projects, and then they have to undertake environmental impact assessments. Persons who are directly affected are allowed under the law to intervene in the approval processes under the acts in order to raise their concerns and defend their interests. In 2011, an oil sands company submitted a request to increase the capacity of its oil sands production. The Pembina Institute and the Fort McMurray Environmental Association then applied under the legislation to file a statement of concern about this plan. Alberta Environment refused to consider the statement of concern and froze the governments out of the entire process. So to their credit, these two groups took Alberta Environment to court. The court's decision, which is in that ruling, was a sharp rebuke of Alberta Environment. It found that Alberta Environment had denied these groups the right to intervene because, get this, essentially, the groups had previously criticized oil sands development. Can you believe it? And they'd been uncooperative with the oil sands industry and government. It looked very much to the judge like Alberta Environment only wanted to hear from people who already agreed with it. Not surprisingly, the judge concluded that Alberta Environment had violated the very legislation it was meant to uphold. To my mind, this is clearly about the Alberta government ignoring the rule of law. to benefit oil sands development. It's an unmistakable example of the petrostate in operation. Finally, let's take a look at the courts themselves. Obviously, from the example I just gave, the courts are terribly important and they are doing some good work. But how long can we count on an independent judiciary? This summer, for one brief day, one newslet, the local CBC radio, carried a story about political influence in the appointment of judges. It should have been, to my mind, a major story, but it disappeared in one day, which says something about the petrostate culture in Alberta. The gist of the story is that when the Alberta government is appointing lawyers to become judges, it favors those who support the Tories. In Alberta, judges are appointed after being approved by two different committees. The first committee broadly represents the legal profession. The second committee, which was brought in by the Tories, is called the Provincial Court Nominating Committee, and 8 of its 11 members are handpicked by the Justice Minister. That's the committee that makes the final recommendation to the minister on who he should appoint as judges. Among its members who have ties to the Tories is its chairman, who was the official agent for Alison Redford's last election campaign. Being that this is Alberta, it shouldn't be a surprise that this fellow's field of law is oil and gas transactions, regulatory matters, and royalty issues. Remember, the nominees approved by this committee become the judges who will eventually hear cases on land claims, environmental violations, labor cases, and election appeals. Where will they stand? The CBC story quoted as one of its sources the former Chief Justice of the Court of Queen's Bench, Alan Walkowicz, one of the most respected judges in Alberta. Judge Walkowicz referred to a culture of patronage that becomes a political barrier to candidates for judgeships who do not support the Conservative Party. When the former Chief Justice of Alberta is raising concerns about political interference in the appointment of judges, every Albertan should be listening. Now, there are many, many other examples. I haven't, for example, said anything about the mainstream media. But you can see from these examples that since the 2008 election, the petroleum industry hasn't just captured the political agenda in Alberta, they've captured the mechanics by which the agenda is set. So what do we do? Well, here's the thing, folks. That's how politics works. It's perfectly legal, and they've been very effective at it. They've been focused and organized, they've worked hard, they have clear goals, and they've succeeded. So, for those of us and you who may want to fight back, there are actually lessons to be learned from their successes. Build alliances, have clear goals, focus, and organize. And remember that even small actions make a difference. If you can't change the world or even the province, then change your neighborhood, change the corner of your block, change yourself. In my experience, arguing and yelling doesn't cause people to change, not nearly as much as do words effectively used. If you think Alberta is becoming a petrostate, then start saying so and explain to everyone why. Petrostate is a powerful word. Politics is a contest, no matter what the system. It always has been and it always will be. Don't get discouraged. There are always ways to stay in the contest, ways to resist, ways to push back. Thank you very much.
Miles, I wonder if I can get your help now. Thank you very much, both of you, Shannon and Kevin, for your chats. I know there's lots of interest in talking. We are going to go into about, Shannon, why don't you come on up to about 25 minutes or so. I'm going to ask a favor of you. I'm going to ask you to self-regulate. You have already spoken and asked a question in this conference. Put your hand down. Okay. It's a good place to start. And then we're gonna do our best to do some gender equity and other equity as much as we can in this. So why don't we start off by with this gentleman in the front, and let's take three questions or three comments and discussions. Go from there.
Okay, a question is for Shannon. One of the things you showed the graphic of all the expense claims of all the government employees, what they ordered for lunch, etc. And then you said, so they're putting all that stuff up, but they're not showing the more bigger substantive things. I guess the question is, what can be done to get those things added to that open data portal? What can we do there?
Hang on to that question. I think there was a woman over here there in the white turtleneck. Can you bring the mic over to her, Miles?
Just maybe a comment. One thing I tried to find was Alberta. The Quality Research Council, Health Quality Council, did a survey on long-term care. They did two surveys, 210 and 212, and they just published the result in aggregate, like by quartile, so we could see which long-term, what the worst performing centers did and what the best. But so I asked them, why don't you actually publish the results per each long-term care center? And their answer was that the long-term care centers wouldn't cooperate with the survey if they did. And secondly, that there were some with very few answers, and the public wouldn't understand that wasn't a good response rate. So just a comment.
Great. And if you just pass the mic in front of you there to the woman in front there.
Just a quick question to compare. Shannon, you talked about the lack of openness, the open data portal, the wrong turn, shooting the messenger, and going from bad to worse in long-term care. I'm just wondering briefly, is Alberta bad to worse compared with other provinces? Like, just a little bit of a comparison with other places. Thank you.
Great, thanks. Are you folks okay standing up, or do you want chairs? Would you prefer chairs? Okay, I'll get them.
No, I'm good standing.
You're good? Okay, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah. First, on expense claims, that's a good question. First thing I would say is, well, we need to demand it, really. I mean, we won't get something we don't ask for. There was just recently a public consultation on the FOIP legislation. Myself and other folks who work on these issues were there asking for exactly that sort of data. The challenge with data issues, and part of Parkland's motivation in having this conference, is they can seem really esoteric. Like, it's, you know, how does that connect to actual action on social justice issues? The problem is, if we don't have the information to even understand the issues, action is a non-starter. So people who care deeply about social justice issues, I think, should also care deeply about information issues. And I think if we can have some of that same passion for social justice around data and evidence and its appropriate use and recognition of its limitations and its powers to explain the world and to point toward corrective action, then we'd be further along the road to making clear that this is something that we need and that the government should give us. The other thing I would say is, don't celebrate when we're thrown a bone. This disclosure of expenses, the sunlighting of salaries, should it come to pass here in Alberta, is not something to be celebrated. It's something to be dismissed and to be moved beyond and to not get in the way of asking for the real stuff. With respect to long-term care, absolutely. That's another example of a sector in which we need data. I would highlight also, and particularly with a nod to the next question, which is how does Alberta fit into national patterns? The lack of data on elder care is a national problem. It's recognized by researchers across the nation. Understanding elder care in Alberta, like understanding any issue in Alberta, is hard to do in a vacuum. We need comparisons. We need the essential data to allow us to tackle the real issues. So it's absolutely a challenge. With respect to other places, well, the challenges in making those comparisons, not surprisingly, pertain to the data. I think I would respond by highlighting, by pointing to one of the things that I highlighted in my talk, and that is that in relation to access to data, privatization is a real problem. That seems to have led in Alberta to less access to information, to barriers being erected toward public understanding of where our taxes are being spent, where our how the government spends its resources. And insofar as Alberta is quite far along the privatization road in relation to other provinces, we've got an even bigger problem in that respect. So I'm sorry I can't be more specific on the national issue. It would be good to have more data.
Kevin, do you have anything that you'd like to add to those?
No.
Okay. So our next question is in back, the person with the black shirt on, and then we're going to go to this gentleman at the end, and then the woman at the back.
Hi, Mike Dempsey. I'm a vice president at AUPE, and I'm also a forest ranger, 32 years of experience, who's watched the staff in his office right beside him go over to the new regulator, the Alberta Energy Regulator. It's actually worse than Kevin's mentioning. They're offering salaries 25 to 100% more to entice over. And guess what? They're not paid out of the public coffers anymore. All the money for their salaries comes from industry. In levies, the companies pay to get their permits to go and drill. So it's all, Kevin's absolutely right that the public has lost their interest in the public land. The public land, the authority to run public land that is under disposition to companies, which is almost half of it, now resides with the companies. They have, through a non-democratic means, have usurped the public's right to control what happens on regulated public land. And one thing about the whistleblower protection, it's not whistleblower protection. What it is if I report that company A has gone and made a big mess in the bush and I shouldn't have done it, and I'm fired, the whistleblower protection, what it does, it'll fine the employer $100,000 maximum, but I don't get my job back. There's just a fine to the employer, and you still have to have a grievance procedure with your collective agreement if you're unionized in order to try and get your job back. So it's not protection. It's just a punitive penalty on whoever fires you.
Thanks. So it's the gentleman with his hand up on the right. Oh, go come back. Sorry. I'm sorry, Miles. Right there. Yeah.
Hi there. I have attended several of these public consultation shams, I guess you could call them. And the overwhelming tone of all of the consultations I've been involved in are in complete opposition to what the government ends out putting forward. So I'm wondering, and they kind of use that, the public input, as a spin and propaganda to say, we've listened to you and we've taken all your things into consideration. So I'm wondering if you could maybe kind of comment on how these public consultations are more of a counterintelligence type of operation by the government to kind of, to put a good public spin and a public image on what they end up doing that seems very unpopular at the end.
Thanks. And the final one on this round will be the woman in the back in the purple.
Thank you. My name is Meenal Srivastav, and I'm a political economist at Athabasca University, who I have been working on sort of oil and democracy connection in the Albertan and Canadian context. And it is really easy to work on that because there is a lot of evidence of how the dependence on oil revenue is affecting democratic institutions. But then you have that, and you have this gathering where people understand the connection. And then you have, for instance, my sort of middle centrist friends who would who voted for PC to stop the wild rose, and now my sort of right-wing acquaintances, because I don't have any right-wing friends, they would want to vote wild rose to stop PC. This is what I'm hearing, and it's really disturbing to see that despite all the evidence that is really available, why is it so difficult to get across this connection to the majority who vote? Because obviously this is not the majority that votes. So my question to you, Kevin, as you know, a politician, is there a way to actually simplify this message that the majority will understand how their interest is connected?
Thanks. Yeah, I don't have any right-wing friends either, only right-wing family. I don't know if that makes any sense. Go ahead.
I need time to think about that one. So, question about the sham consultation processes, that's really what they are. Those came in my experience with the Klein government, and we saw a whole host of those. Those of us who have followed all the summits, the growth summit, and oh God, I can't remember them all. Started to see that in action very quickly, and they are a sham. They're about creating an image of consultation. You see through them. I don't know how many Albertans actually get sucked in by them anymore, but some do. It's so patently obvious. It's hard to think that they work. I don't know, Shannon, if you have anything to add to that. If I knew the answer to that question, I might have a different podium to be standing on right now. I think it's a very complicated issue. And I think if we were honest with ourselves, in some level, we are all complicit in Alberta's economy. This magnificent building, $500 million building. Well, we know how that was paid for. Our taxes generally, I know it's torqued, but in general, our taxes are low. Those of us who own houses, the value of those houses is sustained because of the petroleum boom. So we're all complicit. And even if we're not caught in any of those traps, we still benefit from the petroleum industry. So there's an identity thing, I think, that goes on here where we're being challenged to do something Chris Hedges talked about at the very end last night, which I thought was wonderful. We're being challenged to do something that really makes us uncomfortable, which would be to start, breaking our dependence on the petroleum economy that we benefit from. And that's, most people don't want to go that. You spend your days and your career studying this data. So to you, it's readily available. To me, it's readily available. But to somebody caught up in their day-to-day life, trying to pay the bills, look after the kids, all of that, it's just not so readily available. What's readily available is the broader discourse. And you sit down, you click on the TV, and there's 6 ads every 7 minutes selling you something. And on it goes. So we're in a pretty deep hole here. And I think the first place to look often is in the mirror and say, okay, what can I do? How am I complicit in what's going on? And then talk openly about these issues with your family and friends. That's probably not a real good issue. A crisis will come, and the crisis will force change. Which way that change goes is anybody's guess. But it may, whether we change from Wild Rose to PC, that's not a change at all. I'll stop there.
Shannon, do you have
How are we doing?
Oh, we're okay.
Yeah. Good. Okay. I appreciate the clarification about whistleblower protection. It's important to be clear about that. Also, with public consultation, yes, I agree. As someone in my position, I find it hard to know what to do with those situations. I participate in them. I want to monitor the state of debate. Public consultations are something of value. It's a form of communication. But when they're being used as a sham, is the logical reaction to completely disengage with them or to participate them and try to work within the frame that you're offered, as inadequate and flawed as it may be? I don't know. I do know that in the consultations that I've attended in person, there have certainly been people there who were doubtful, distrustful of the process. There were also people there who were just doing their best and bringing their perspective and expecting to be heard. It's a challenge. It's a bit of an exercise for me to go in and deliberately refuse the frames. You know, to when they start talking about choice and how all Albertans want choice in whatever sphere. Most recently, in terms of that language is often bandied about in relation to residential elder care. Albertans want choice. Not if you're 85 and really sick. Choice is not the foremost on your brain. It might be foremost on your brain when you're 50 and well. So to engage directly with those sorts of frames that are put out there as if they were right in the heart of all Albertans, as if we all agree this isn't something we need to debate. And so to interrogate that language in whatever context, whether it's in the public consultation setting or whether it's in, as Kevin was suggested earlier, the conversation with your friends, I guess. The other one that, so choice is good, I refuse. I also refuse tax is bad, which is another narrative that we're offered always here in Alberta, and it's bandied around like absolute common sense. So making those connections between taxes and public services and conversations, just those little rhetorical things could seem to me, if it's a way of working toward change. I'll leave it
Great. There. We have a question just down here, and then we'll go to you. And is there a third question? Oh, we'll come down to here, and then we'll go to you next, Vika.
This is just a comment. I can't resist responding to what Shannon just said. There is no magic number that says this is how high the taxes should be. What the public wants is value for money. And from that perspective, the Conservative government's taxes are way too high. I just wanted to give you an example, not from the oil patch. A few days ago, I was looking for some information on AISH, the Assured Income for the Severely Handicapped. So I went through the Department of Human Services annual reports for the last 2 years, and what I could not find was how many people there are on AISH, how many people there are, sort of time series going back in time. I couldn't find out how many people had applied. I couldn't find out how many people had been turned down. What I could find was that they'd done a survey of the people who'd received supplementary benefits, and they didn't tell us the exact numbers, but a percentage of them appreciated getting those benefits. Now, 20-odd years ago, I used to work for the government and had a hand in producing annual reports, and we could at least guarantee that people could read the reports and get some general idea of what the department was up to.
Thanks. Our next one is here, this woman in the knit sweater, for a bit lack of a better description. And then we're going to come down here for the next question after that. If you can keep your questions, we're just getting a little short on time, so if you can keep them brief so that we have time to answer. Thanks.
Thanks. Elizabeth May was recently in Calgary on her Save Democracy from Politics tour, and she spoke a lot about how our systems of government in Canada are kept in check, yes, by rules, but also by self-restraint on the part of those in power, politicians and bureaucrats. And it seems, from what you're both saying, that there's been a shift in kind of the acceptable norms of behavior for people in power, whether it comes to transparency with respect to P3s or conflicts of interest at the AER. Are there specific reforms that we should be fighting for, like more rules to keep people in check, or are there other ways that we can call this behavior out?
Down in the front, and Fike, if you can keep it short, I'm going to get yours in too, because then we'll answer them all at the end.
Yeah, my question is for Kevin. You mentioned collaboration, I think, was the word you used earlier, and I think that's really important. I just want to say there's a quote from John Ralston Saul essay in a recent Adbusters where he says that people on the left are very good at opposing power, and they're very good at critiquing power, but they're not very good, at least recently, they're not very good at taking power. So I want to ask you about one of those institutions that can take power, which is political parties in Alberta. So my question is, do you believe that on their own, the Liberals or the NDP or the Green Party or the Alberta Party can take power? And if not, what would you recommend?
Okay, I'll make sure this is short and sweet. Really appreciate the conversation, and my hat's off to Kevin. Extremely impressed with your presentation, and I'm just looking at the messages that I heard from you, amongst many, is the fact that the arguing and yelling doesn't help change, but the words do. And politics is a contest, and there are ways to resist, and there are ways to push back. And why are you not part of this?
Okay, great. So you have 3 minutes. We're going to have to rush through that. These are all questions that we could have taken the whole hour today.
Shannon will
answer all the politics questions.
Okay. Just quickly, I take the point about taxes. I think what I was meaning is tax as an ideal thing, not necessarily as it's utilized in Alberta. So the idea of tax is not bad, even though we may have opinions about how it's deployed. In relation to the Elizabeth May change in behaviors of people in positions of power, again, I would point to information. We need to be able to monitor what's going on, to know what's going on, before we can even be sure how to proceed most effectively. So I would say, fight for good data.
Rules and regulations do matter, and we're watching that play out right now in the Senate. And one of the checks and balances, the Deloitte auditors were phoned up, and they refused to cooperate, from how I'm reading the media. That's encouraging. So standards matter, keeping standards public, talking about standards. The whole debate around queue jumping, for example, in one sense, that report didn't achieve anything. But to me, the most important thing it did is it reinforced how important it is not to queue jump. It just reinforced a norm. So regulations matter, laws matter, talking matters. That's not a very good answer, but it's going to get worse from here, I'm afraid. I'm going to be candid here. I'm not active in politics anymore. I do not believe that the Liberals, the Alberta Liberals, the Alberta New Democrats, the Alberta Party, or the Greens, on their own, as you put it, Evan, are going to take over the government in the foreseeable future. That's a challenge. I don't have the answer to that challenge. People have talked about cooperation, collaboration. That's been. I'm defeated by that, or I'm. I don't have an answer to that. But something's got to change. It may be the force of history that brings about a change. But right now, I don't think the way things are going that the progressive parties are having the effect they need to have, and they're just incredibly far from forming a government in Alberta. And that was kind of a personal question, I guess. I'm still speaking out, and there's different ways to be involved and different things that we can each do. And I hope each one of us, I don't think you have to be the leader of the opposition or an MLA to make a difference.
Thanks. I don't know. Personally, I think I've heard more from Kevin Taft since he left the legislature than when he was there. He seems to be everywhere these days. That is not an aspersion on when you were there. You were great. That came out wrong. So I have three people to thank. First of all, I want to thank you folks. You were it was an amazingly respectful conversation, and I think you did a really wonderful job, and thank you for that. But of course, to our two speakers, Shannon and Kevin, thank you very much. And Parkland has a token of appreciation for you. I think they have a sound. So from here, you have about 15 minutes, and then our last plenary of the day.